Hello, church family. I hope and trust that you're all well. I'm giving you a little different look this week. I'm here in my back patio where the sights, sounds, and smells of spring are everywhere, in particular these lemon blossoms behind me. Spring is a sign of new life, but there's no greater sign of new life than the resurrection of our Lord. And that's what I'm hoping this will bring to mind. I'm hoping that this last Sunday, even if you had to be alone or you were able to be with someone else, your family perhaps at home, that whatever was happening in your life, you were able to grab a hold of the central truth of the hope that lies in the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. That was my hope. I hope that the Lord ministered to you. I want to tell you just a few things about that. I want to say that there are other signs of new life that have taken place while we haven't been able to meet here for 4 or 5 weeks. First of all, little Levi Chan was born on April 11th, 9 pounds, 2 ounces to Daniel and Cheryl Chan. Congratulations to them, and congratulations as well to Nelson and Jennifer Nunez on the birth of their little daughter, Joy. She was born on March 19th, weighing 7 pounds, 13 ounces. Who knows, perhaps this boy and girl, when they grow up later, they can get together and talk about being pandemic babies. Everyone's healthy. Everyone's happy right now. We praise the Lord for that. So Sherry and I, we're still waiting for grandson number 6, so we ask you to pray for Beth Ann and for Jordan as it's any day now for them as well. I do want to thank you for sharing the link and inviting people, as many of you did, to our Easter services and to also to Good Friday service. I want to tell you that on Good Friday, there were some 362 independent connections viewing that. And that's easily 100 extra than normal. That's easily also about 500 people when each connection is not just one individual. And we had a little more than that on Easter Sunday as well. And you know, people return too. We're not necessarily keeping track of that. I'm not informing you of that. People return Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, today, and they'll watch later or they'll watch again and think about it. So keep praying. Keep praying that the word that went out would continue to bear fruit, that God's Spirit would do a work in the hearts of those people who are listening to it. Now, of course, right now as I speak to you, I'm just thanking you for inviting people, and I'm asking you to stay with that. Keep praying and sharing. Share in prayer. Think of those two words as you think of the future and inviting people who may not have a church to go to, at least during this time, or maybe have never done. Their hearts are still open, I think, to hearing about eternal things. Remember what C.S. Lewis has said, and I've mentioned it before, that pain is God's megaphone. It gets our attention. We had, in addition to some of the states that I mentioned last week listening in, we had people listening in from Colorado, Florida, Idaho, Illinois, Nebraska, Oregon, Pennsylvania, Texas, Wyoming, Nevada, Missouri, Washington, Oklahoma, and once again, some of our mission partners and their friends listening in from Mexico and also from Costa Rica. And that's just our stream. The Hispanic ministry stream also had people listening in from all over the place. So again, share and prayer. Keep those two words in mind. You know, towards the end of our time on Sunday, I mentioned that I'd be teaching at Fair Oaks, and I didn't say enough about that. I think maybe confused some people. I just hadn't planned to say anything. It just kind of came out as I was standing there. Fair Oaks has been without a pastor now for many months, and they've had people doing a pulpit supply coming in and filling in over the weeks. And they've used several of our friends from our seminary, and they reached out to me as well. And so I'm going to be pre-recording messages this Friday and next Friday for them to air them on Sunday. So be praying for them. It's got to be a hard time to go through all this and have nobody as a pastor currently involved in sharing and caring for them at all. I also want to talk a little bit about giving. I mentioned that we praise the Lord that we got ahead at the end of March, and that's largely because of your generosity and God moving your heart and His faithfulness. And also we had 5 Sundays in March. Where we are now in April, just a tiny bit behind. We'll see what the Lord is doing. But the two things that I failed to mention last Wednesday in my podcast was to tell you, one, that the online giving is secure. Everything that can be done has been done. Some people were wondering about that. But also, it does cost us a little bit. There's a little bite that they take, a little percentage. So if you know, mailing your offerings and us handling it, all of that is going to take more work, but it will leave more of God's funds where they are to be used for His kingdom and for His work. So you can do that with what you want. Either way works. I'm just letting you know these things, making sure that's clear. So are you all Zoom experts yet? Everyone left and right is learning how to use online platforms to communicate, like GoToMeeting and Zoom. We have 17 or 18 of our community groups using Zoom. The elders use different platforms to talk. I know that's different men's groups and women's groups are communicating through Zoom. The men's Friday morning prayer meeting has increased in size due to Zoom. You're all invited, men. I think you all get that invite. You could tune in early Friday mornings for the prayer meeting. Also, I was talking to Chris about youth ministry. He said that, yeah, they're holding a lot of interactions with the different groups within the youth ministry, but they have held two, you know, youth group-wide hangout meetings, and one of them was 60 people involved in. So that's amazing. I'm not sure what the gallery view looks like on that, or even if that's possible. But why am I telling all this? All of this just to say, do what you can to stay in touch with one another. On Sunday, I mentioned you ought to call someone you miss, someone you haven't seen in some time, in any way, give them a call, encourage them. There's some people who are feeling very alone throughout all this, and they'd love to hear from you. So take a moment to call somebody that you haven't seen. Stay in touch with one another. Well, as we finish our time this week, I want to take a few minutes to meditate on the ending of 1 Corinthians 15. I didn't say a whole lot on Sunday about that when we finished, mostly because I was applying the sermon for the most part to those who are yet to come to faith. But I wanted to point out that what Paul says at the end of 1 Corinthians 15 is something that applies to us directly as Christians. In fact, he wrote that chapter, remember, to Christians. And the reason he wrote it is he wanted them to be convinced, to be assured of the promise of the future resurrection. If you remember, he had to write that because some in Corinth were actually saying there is no resurrection of the dead. And Paul showed that the resurrection of Jesus and our future resurrection are inextricably connected. That's why he said Christ is the first fruits of a whole harvest. You can't separate them. If there is no future resurrection, by implication, that means Christ wasn't raised from the dead. And if he wasn't raised, the whole Christian faith falls apart like a house of cards. Your faith is futile, he says. We're even liars because we're telling people that God raised him from the dead, but he didn't, if in fact there is no future resurrection. So he wanted them to be assured, to be convinced that we will be raised from the dead. We will be made like him when we see him, Paul says elsewhere in Philippians. And we'll be transformed, our bodies, into the likeness of his bodies by the same power that God exerted when he raised his son from the grave, from the tomb. So that is the hope of glory. That is the heart and soul, the hope of our future glory. Now, but what about the present? How does that affect the way we live now? Well, the church, Christians, we are God's present to this present age from the future age. What I mean is, you remember, to be a Christian is to live in overlapping ages. The future has broken in through the gospel into the present. We have been born again. We have the indwelling Holy Spirit. It's not complete. That's why Paul says that we groan. We groan in these bodies for it to be complete, just as the creation groans. But nevertheless, we are the only ones who have the power of the future already at work in the present. And therefore, our lives, our Christian lives, ought to be examples, foretastes, previews of what God's going to do in human beings in the future. Not perfectly, of course, you know, we're not entirely sanctified and glorified, but we're told that the fruit of the Spirit, and in particular love, is that great Christian virtue, is a sign to the world of the reality of God's being present in us, and that the resurrection is true and real because we've gone through a spiritual resurrection already with Christ Jesus. Jesus said, "They will know you are my disciples by the love that you have for one another." And so what I'm sharing with you is this, that this is a time in the world that brings the best out of the people and the worst out of people. And the church of all people ought to be people who demonstrate the love of Christ. They will know that we are Christians by the way we care for one another here in the church, but also how we love our neighbor as ourselves. So I encourage you deeply to persevere in that. In fact, Paul ends with an exhortation. The implications of knowing that you're going to rise from the dead, you're going to enter into the new creation, is this. He says, "Therefore, my beloved brothers, Be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. Those three verbs there are key. He says, here's three things to remember. Because the resurrection is real, you are to be steadfast and immovable. Those two verbs primarily apply to be your commitment in the faith. Remain true to Christ. Remain true to the gospel. Then lastly, it's about how we live. He says, be abounding in the work of the Lord. Super abounding in the work of the Lord. Now, what does that mean? Well, on one level, it does mean gospel ministry, but it doesn't only mean simply professional ministry like me. Abounding in the work of the Lord is doing everything in the name of the Lord, as Paul says in Colossians. As you parent for the sake of Christ, as you live as a single for the sake of Christ, as you work for the sake of Christ, the way you speak, the way you carry yourself, the way you handle your finances, and yes, of course, the way we use our spiritual gifts in the name of the Lord, and share the gospel with one another and with others, that is abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord, because you are in Christ and he was the first fruits of a great harvest to come, your work in the Lord, all the suffering, the difficulty you and I face, all the pressing on is not in vain. You see, the hope of glory is that strong foundation that motivates us to live right in the present. If we look to the present only for motivation, then that's going to lead to disillusionment. Because, you know, in the present, it's about groaning in this body. There's two steps forward and one step back. And so our hope to persevere comes from knowing that there's going to be a new heavens, a new earth. We're going to share in it. And the way we lived in this life is going to make a difference in that life. It's going to impact people now for eternity. So I encourage you with those words, persevere. Be steadfast, immovable. Be true to Christ. Be encouraged. God is on the throne. Abound in the work of the Lord as you call people and speak to them. And as we live our lives here, as this whole thing begins to unfold in the months ahead, may we be a great sign of what the future world is going to be like, even in its imperfection. As for us and our family, I just invite you to keep praying for Sherry and I as we seek to care for my parents during this difficult time with their health issues and our own personal challenges. I'm teaching a seminary class now on Wednesdays. In fact, I got to wrap this up here and get going on that. And then, of course, these two Fridays. Again, I'm filming on Friday for Fair Oaks and then speaking on Sunday. Lots going on. Be encouraged. The Lord is with you and he's with me. God bless you.